People say, well, somebody is the Heifetz of broadcasting, or somebody is the Rolls-Royce of performers, or somebody is the incredible essence of professionalism. And Bing was all of that. Rosemary Clooney and Vera Ellen had done a number called Sisters.
Danny Kaye.
And Bob Alton, who was the choreographer, got an idea that it would be kind of fun for us to come out and pull our pants up, you know, and have big bands on our head and big fans and do the number that they had just sung. We would mouth the words and then we would do the number that they did. And Bing said, well, I don't know. He said, you know, you're pulling up your pants and you're kind of... I said, well, come on, Bing. You know, everybody will know we're having fun and we're kidding. Why don't we just shoot it and see how you like it, you know? And he was rather reluctant to do it, I must say. But after some persuasion, he said, well, we'll try it. And listen, if it doesn't turn out right, we won't have it in the picture. I said, well, fine, just take a look at it. Have an open mind. So we shot the number. We did it once, I believe. And at one point, I don't know whether I was hitting him in the elbow and in his tummy, or he was hitting me or whatever, but he broke up like crazy at the end of the tape. And I fully expected them to say, okay, that was fine, now let's do one seriously. So I think we did another one. And then we said, well, mark both of them and we'll look at them in the projection room. And when we did look at him, he really broke up in the projection room. And he said, oh, I think that's going to be fine.
Through his recordings and his movies, I became a singer. I copied his style of singing. I tried to copy his acting. In fact, about everything he did, I tried to do. Harry Como copied him. Frank Sinatra copied him. And the rest of them copied him just to get started. Then they developed their own style. But it was Bing that started. I lost a good friend. Truly good friend. And I think the whole world has lost a beautiful human being.
And when he hit those low notes, oh, I just used to wait for those low notes. They just were so deep and so clear. And I felt that he started the kind of singing that everybody, especially the young men of the day, are singing. It never affected him, him being such a great star. He always just had that casual way, as if, well, I love to sing, I love my golf, and I love people. And if I can make them happy, that's the important thing. He never, ever carried himself to say, I'm a superstar. He's just a beautiful man, and it's too bad that he never sometime ever said to himself, well, I'm really that great. But that's the way he was, and that's what made people love him so much, because he never realized that he let them think it, and that's a beautiful thought. To let other people feel how great you are.
There was a dance sequence coming up.
Fred Astaire.
We had together, and everybody had said, well, Crosby is very casual, you know, he doesn't rehearse much, he just does it. Well, I was very much surprised to see him arrive in the rehearsal hall that day, that first rehearsal, with practice clothes, sweatshirts, towels, dancing shoes, limbering up. Well, you know, well, he thinks more about what he has to do than people realized. He thought about all his other work about the same way. But when I saw him in practice clothes, I just broke up. And then we went to work, and by golly, he did dance well. You know, he could do anything in his own way that would be the unique thing. He asked me, who is the best? Who's the best dancer of all your partners? So I would always get out of it by saying, Bing Crosby.
Oh, I've had so many, you know. See, I had the good fortune that we lived together for 4 months in England when we did Road to Hong Kong. So I got a lot of great recollections of him.
About 2 days before it was supposed to happen, he turned to me in the car. He said, I'll work on stage. See, I said, you're kidding. He said, no, I'll go on stage. He didn't want to put his toupee on, you know, and walk around, unless he was on stage. And he went on stage at 40 minutes. And you never saw a happier audience in your life, you know? But he didn't want to walk through the lobby, you know. But he went backstage and did it, you know, which I thought was marvelous. He was thinking all the time. Of course, I've had so many wonderful moments with him, you know, the fun moments and the pictures. And yeah, we had a lot of fun. He's one guy we really miss.
Crosby was the best. Crosby and I were
great. Like,
we were just so lucky because we meshed in our thinking, and Bing was an underrated comedian because he did so many straight things. But Bing was a very fine light comedian, and I taught him how to be heavy. I put the turkey bladder on him, and I'll tell you, he enjoyed it. And we had great success with our road pictures, and he had more fun, and we had more fun doing it because it was wide open where you could ad lib, and that was fun.
Right after the thing, Bing threw himself into my arms, which was something else, you know, because he was cool, and he'd have fun with you and laugh with you, but I never saw that kind of tenderness in a guy and that kind of emotion with a fella. And it shocked me a little, but I thought it was just sensational.
When you and Bing would play, who was the better player?
Bing was the better player most of the time because he really concentrated on it. He was a fine golfer. And he used to come into Paramount with his shoes unlaced in the morning at 9 o'clock. And I'd say, don't you have time to lace your shoes? He said, I stopped at Wilshire Country Club and hit a bucket of balls in the morning before we started working. So he deserved to be a fine player.
He was serious about it.
Yeah, he was.
You know, he was a fine actor, as he proved in Going My Way, where he played a priest. Of course, I always kidded him about that, because how could a man with that many kids play a priest? I mean, you really have to be a fine actor for that.
No, I read one paragraph in some paper that after he saw the book, he said, that's not the book that I wrote. So I think what they did, I think the ghost took it and kind of twisted it around for him to make it commercial for the ghost, you know? Which they do. I think they did that to Christine Crawford. I said the other day, I wonder if Gary Crosby and Christine Crawford are the same person. You know? No, but that's the thing today. You know, that's the thing, to write something provocative. It doesn't pay to die anymore. It can ruin your career. I don't think he got the coat hangers from Joan Crawford at all. I just think it's a lot of con. I think it's all done for money. And I knew those kids since they were about 2 feet high, and they used to come over to my house and sing it on the holidays, you know, bring the four of them in without unannounced, and they'd sing a couple of carols, and I'd give them a cookie and they'd leave, you know. And I watched them grow, and I was with them a lot, and they were all very happy. And when they got to be taller, they got to be about 4 or 5 feet, they joined up. Remember they had the quartet going, the four of them, and I paid them $25,000 just to come on my show, and they didn't need the money. But I just don't believe any of that.
You knew Bing, of course, for how many years, really?
Well, yeah, I worked with him about 42 years, you know, and or knew him. I didn't work with him 42, but I knew him that long. And Bing was a very charitable guy. He's not the kind of a guy that went around screaming about the things he did, but he did some good things, and he was a very loyal fella to his friends. And I just don't buy that routine at all. I don't think that's was in his makeup. And George Burns has the right idea. He's not going, you know. I said on my show that, you know, I'm going to have the kids write the book now so I can check it. And if I don't like it, I can take them out of my will.
I'm wondering, are there any recordings of Bing's that have been particular favorites of your own?
No, not really. You know, the thing like Pennies from Heaven and different records. I dig all his records because naturally we all think the same about Bing's recordings. Or, you know, he's one of the great voices of history. And I enjoy most of them. Most of the time I enjoy the ones I'm singing with him.
I don't think I ever heard him say an unkind word about anyone. Or if he did criticize someone, it was done with great humor and great, how can I say, sweetness and understanding of the person and the situation. Bing had a way of creating an ease and good humor with everyone around him. I think he was a little anxious about this part. It was something quite different. It was a departure from anything he had done before. And in the beginning, he was rather uneasy about it. And it showed he was tense and nervous the first few days. But George Seton was a wonderful director and a very warm, understanding person. And I think put Bing at ease very quickly and very easily. And it all went very smoothly after that.
And I think when they first got married, everybody was saying, this will never work. They were telling her, I said, you marry him, he's going nowhere. You got no chance. Don't go near him, you know. And thank God they got married. And my mother was a tremendously sensitive lady, was very shy, very introverted, hated being in show business, couldn't stand it, but loved it, but hated it. You know, she was so afraid anytime she had to perform. So this was ideal for her to get out of the business and find somebody she loved and raise a family. Bound and determined that we were not going to be what he termed showbiz kids. So when it would come time for us to do like his Christmas show, or I had a little part in a movie with him, something like that, I would never know about it until probably the morning that we were going to shoot it or record it or whatever it was. And then he'd come in the room and say, hey, come on with me, I want you to do something. And we'd go do whatever it was. And when we'd get done, that night at home, he'd say, now remember, that doesn't make you anybody special. The doctor called my dad in and told him. My dad was scheduled to go to Europe to make a picture called Little Boy Lost at the time. His son won't go. I'll stay here. And the doctor says, you can't do that. Because if you stay here, if you drop this picture, she's going to know something's wrong with her. And it's going to affect her. So he had to go and do the picture like nothing was wrong. That must have been a load. That must have been a load. New family's something else. It was really a kick to go up there to the house up in Hillsborough and stay over, you know, 2 or 3 days, my wife and I. And I just kind of walk around and clock off the things that those kids could get away with that we didn't, you know. And I think a couple of little things he said to me in the last few years, I think he might have learned from us, because they can joke with him and they can kid with him, they can throw lines back and ask questions and things like that. I can see him looking sometimes. There's times when he'd like to reach. He would have liked to have reached and tagged one of them a couple of times. But he just kind of held it back, and he'd just look at him and nod like this, and then I would look over, and he'd look at me, and he'd give me one of those eye takes like this, like, I'm trying, man, I'm trying, you know. But they, and don't get me wrong, it wasn't permissive city up there. They got rules and regs, too. They're about half again as loose as they were on us, though. And I'm happy to see that. I'm glad to see these kids, they can joke with him a lot more. They could throw their arms around him a lot more and kid him and play with him, you know, more than we could. With us, it was more or less of a God talking from the mountain routine. Not a natural, normal thing to him to be affectionate in front of others or spend a lot of time telling you how much he loves you. But it was there. He could deal with emotions like affection and love in the personality that he put on for the world, that breezy, kind of semi-comedic guy who was Mr. Cool, and he could call you nicknames and funny nicknames and have funny little sayings. If you hadn't seen him in a couple of years, he'd hit you with a couple of zingers as you came toward him. That meant everything was okay. That meant I love you. That meant everything's cool, you know. I sometimes feel that he would have liked to have been able to be more demonstrative than he was. I think that was a thing that bothered him. He really was kind of withdrawn as far as touching or hugging or any of that went.
I don't think my father was acting much different than any of the other fathers of the time. The rules were there. They were laid down. They were expected to be obeyed. If they weren't obeyed, certain punishments were assigned. And those were the punishments that took place, and you never had a side to the story.
He had difficulty expressing love. So that when he would take you walking and hold your hand, it was a terribly precious moment and valued as such, you know? Because the love was expressed, but not in a very physical way. And when it was expressed physically, it was so precious. We're a very, very close-knit family, and Daddy spent the majority of time with us or taking us to travel with him so that we were always together, and we weren't a very social family. We were a unit that did things as a family, and other people weren't really invited to join in. It was very private and very personal.
First family came along, he wasn't around at all. He was working, he was at the top of the heap, and he just wasn't there. And so when we were born, he really wanted to be there and to do it differently. And so we grew up outside of Hollywood. He didn't think it was a great place to raise kids, so we grew up outside of San Francisco. And we had so much time with him. I'm so grateful. I knew Gary. He was someone that I actually had contact with. And he was one of the angrier men I've known. But he also had been a raging alcoholic and become sober. And we went out to lunch after that book came out. And he literally told me in tears that they had said, the worse this is, the more books will sell. And he apologized to me for that. I felt like it doesn't really matter because you've trashed your father, and that's permanent. People can always trash talk. It's the easiest thing to do. You can always lower the bar.
They weren't gonna give Louis any Billy at all, as far as I know. And Dad said, well, I'm gonna go golfing, and when you figure it out, you come get me. He basically got the first equal billing for a black person in a white movie, and I'm so proud of that.
Daddy didn't really know what to do with a girl. He had six boys, so he treated me like a boy. So this was my first big fish, and I caught it with him. I was very proud of it. My mother said, no, you may not stuff that fish. If you stuff it, you have to live with it. So I lived with a 136-pound marlin on my bedroom wall for 12 years until I moved out of the house. I loved it. I'm a terrible tomboy, and much of that I attribute to Dad. But he also, as I got older, I realized that there were other things I had to learn. And so when we went on the road together as a family unit, I got to sing a duet with him. I got to sing a couple. And that was a really privilege and a gift. And I would stand in the wings every night and watch him work, because he was so good at what he did, and he was so honest and true.
When we were performing and making a picture, he just couldn't bear to do the love scenes. I think he was shy in a strange way. And he would put off the kissing scenes to the very last day. even when we'd make still pictures, he really didn't like to take any kissing. And I don't remember any still that I ever made where we were in an embrace. And I think it was difficult for him to be close to another, to a woman. I think his best friends were his men friends. You know, they did golf, and he loved to be off with the boys. But he was very shy of ladies. I don't think he was shy all the time, because he certainly had a lot of ladies after him. And they'd say, you're on, and he would be chewing gum, because that kept his mouth from getting dry or whatever. And I'd see him put over there, and he'd stash it away and go right on singing with his mouth, with chewing gum in his mouth, but no one ever knew it. Oh, and we had marvelous times. He dropped the script. The whole thing fell on the floor. But and here's the mic at the top, and he absolutely goes right on talking, and he goes down, and once he did this when he was singing, and he was going, ba 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 bee, ba 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 da, and even ad-libbing in a song, and never missed a beat, never got off the once. And it was fabulous, because nothing bothered him. I was so thrilled about, he seemed so very happy. And he said, Mary, I've never known such happiness as I have with Kathy. He said, it was a second chance in my life to have this kind of life, and to have this wonderful girl. Suddenly, she came to interview him once, and that's how they met. Did you know that? And she apparently did very well with the interview, because he eventually married her, and he said, I'm glad to tell you that I married a Texas gal. She's from Galveston.
He made you so easy. He was so easy. I learned something from Bing. Bing was never late for anything. He was the most conscientious, the most careful performer of anyone I knew. Bing never sang out of tune. Bing never told a joke that hadn't been well-structured. He never delivered a line that didn't have a beginning and a middle and an end. This is a wonderful way of speaking and a way of thinking, and it was a facile mind that was very aware of where it was going. In other words, he did not have a sloppy way of thinking. That casualness could never be construed for sloppiness.
Still hasn't become a reality to me. For as long as I can remember, along with just about everybody else in the four corners of the globe, he has been a part of my life. And I thought he would always be here. Well, of course he will be because of the legacy he has left us. It wasn't only the music that was different. The man was different. And he established what we fondly believe the typical American image to be. Easygoing, yet strong, witty, articulate, sporting, casual, gentlemanly, and above all, original.
I met Bing when he was doing Road to Bali, and I had been to the lot a couple of times, and Bing was on his bicycle, and his shirt exactly matched his eyes, which was a stunning thing to see, because he had great eyes. He had great blue eyes.
He was the most professional man that I've ever known. I think that I learned more from him working with him the first year that we worked together in radio, even before any of the television or records or even White Christmas, any of the things that we did. I learned from him every day that I worked with him. Even the most difficult, people that had the most difficult reputation of being difficult to work with suddenly shaped up with Bing because they respected him. I think that Bing could seem removed from events. I think that he could walk away from a situation that called for perhaps more emotion than he was willing to show at that time. He was tremendously approachable for people to walk up to Bing Crosby and say hello was the easiest thing in the world for most people to do. I think in back of that initial friendliness, perhaps, was a reserve that existed for almost everybody. He was not cold. He was terrifically compassionate to me on many, many occasions when I was not even aware that he was aware that I needed something, a kind word from a friend. I saw him do something at the Palladium. It was the first time that we were there, and you cannot imagine the excitement and the joy of the people that were watching him. They would stand on their chairs and scream. It was like one voice. And at the end of one performance, it might have been the last night and perhaps the night before the last night, but it was toward the end of our engagement, and I saw him say, "I love you," to the audience. And I had never seen Bing or heard Bing say that to another living soul. I knew her when she was a newly married young girl who was always dressing in black to seem older, I think. She did not have an easy life with Bing. She had a full life with Bing. And he loved her very, very much. And she adored him. Anything that that seems untoward in Catherine's personality perhaps has to be understood. She needs a libretto a little bit, simply because sometimes she would take responsibility for things that Bing wanted, and she knew that Bing wanted, and could not articulate, so that she would say, could we have things this way? And suddenly everyone would say, oh boy, you know, if only Bing's wife were as easygoing as Bing. Well, the reason she was doing it was because Bing wanted it that way. And so Catherine took the rap, but she did it willingly.
My fondest memory is just being able to further my friendship, deepen the friendship that I had with Bing. That's the thing that came out of the picture that I was left with for the rest of Bing's life. That was very important to me.
What was it like working with Bing Crosby in his movies, and what do you think of the book Gary Crosby is bringing out?
I don't know anything about the book that Gary's bringing out. Gary brought over some pages that had to do with my sister because they used to go out together. And so those pages that I was interested in and involved in, I okayed for him, and that part of it was just fine. So I don't know about the rest of it. A friend of mine read a review and said that it was like Daddy Dearest. I tend to wonder about that, though, because in the final analysis, you know, Bing was a human being. He just had a very high profile for about 50 years, and that would be difficult for any of us, wouldn't it?
Can you tell us a little bit about working with him? Because I think
the best. He was my teacher. He was the most professional man that I'd ever met in my life. You'd better know your part before you got there, because he was letter perfect by the time you got to the first rehearsal.
And he seemed to like a lot of children too, didn't he?
He did, indeed. It's called Vatican Roulette. In many ways, the thing that really changed it for me, though, in a kind of a national and international way, was Bing. Because he asked me to do the shows that he started doing, and he had never done personal appearances before. So this was a joy for me and such a tremendous success, because people, I think, just went through life never thinking that they would see Bing Crosby in person, and here they had a chance to do it, and it was just thrilling to be a part of it.
Well, tell us a little bit. Give us a story of what that must have been like.
Like Bing?
Yeah. The two of you doing some things.
Well, he used to hide his scotch bottle from me in the back of the television set. I don't know why that came to me, but it's really true. He used to do that. Then he borrowed my Vic salve all the time, never brought it back. He's so comfortable on the stage that it's just wonderful to see. We were at the Palladium. And instead of, at the Palladium shows usually work so that you have, the first half will be a lot of opening acts, and then the star comes out in the second half. Well, Bing didn't want to do it that way. He had 40 musicians on the stage, and the curtains would open, and they'd play When the Blue of the Night Meets the Gold of the Day, and he'd walk on the stage. Well, those people would stand on their seats and just applaud. And
were you real scared?
No.
You weren't?
No. No, the first time, probably the first night at the Dorothy Chandler Pavilion, I was terrified. I had new material, and I was holding the material, you know, the songs like this, and reading them and trying to memorize. At that late date, it was a little late to start, but I had started early. Anyway, I was doing that, and he said, "Why are you so scared?" And I said, "I just am." And he said, "Well, they're not going to form a posse and come up and get you, so relax a little bit." He was that way, though. He felt very, very comfortable with people. It's great.
That you had worked with him for 26 years.
Isn't that right? Yeah, that's right. I didn't realize that either until you just said it. My goodness, that's a long time. That is a long time.
Is it true that you used to do his radio show when you were expecting? He would come to your house and record the radio show?
Yes, yes. But the way that it happened was, we used to go to the studio to do all the music, you know. But then one time I couldn't leave the house when we had to do some of the radios, because they were on every day.
Yeah.
So they set up in the living room, and he kind of liked that. He only had to come about 10 minutes away. And so he said, "Well, we'll do it from here, from now on." So
that's
what we used to do. We would.
And nobody knew that.
No. No, the sound was pretty good, you know, and we would set up and do all the commercials first. And then we'd break out the ice, and Ken Carpenter and Bing and I would sit down.
El Scotcherino.
A little Scotcherino. Why not? Yes.
How many clam bakes did you do, too?
Oh, wow. I guess about 10.
That's the first time we worked. We were doing a clam bake with Phil Harris and Bing. And Rosie sang three songs and got out of the room.
Oh, yes.
It was a stag.
Oh, that's right. And you know, Bing used to really, he'd say, "I'll come and get you. You just stay in your dressing room,
right,
and I'll come and get you when it's time for it." He wouldn't let me stay.
Why? What did you guys
Phil Harris would get a little crazy.
Really, for once, I did something smart. Bing Crosby and you were working in New York City.
At the Eurus.
And I went to see the show. I said, "You know, I never saw Bing Crosby in person. I'm going to go see that show." It was great.
Wasn't it a thrill? The way that the audience reacted to him.
It was crazy.
He would walk out on the stage
everybody's going crazy.
Well,
is that true?
He was a tradition. I mean, he was standard. You know, I didn't realize, I don't think, how important Bing Crosby was until I was in Calcutta, India during the war. And I passed this little store, and a guy sitting there with a turban and sheets on, and he was playing Crosby records on a Victrola.
You're kidding me.
That is big.
That's important.
He had a marvelous sense of humor, which I don't think a lot of people knew about.
The best. Oh, I think they did. All
he
the things.
He kidded about himself, didn't he?
Terrifically. You know, he used himself as the. He would tell great stories about himself. There was one thing that happened in London, the last time that we worked there.
Which was just before he died.
Yes, we were there for 2 weeks, and he used to take his toupee off after he finished the performance, and he used to carry it back and forth to his house in a little kind of a cardboard box, you know, with a rubber band around it. It looked kind of dumb, but he'd put it in an Aer Lingus bag and go home, you know. So he came to work one night, and he said, I had a kind of a scare tonight. I couldn't find the red cardboard box. Because we had a new maid, and she threw it out. And I said to him, you know, the way that he found it was hysterical because he went through the garbage. Can you see Bing Crosby on the back stoop someplace going through the garbage? That's how he found it.
You know, in retrospect, it would have made no difference at all, right?
He felt as though it did. He wanted to. He didn't like to wear it, and he would not wear it when he was out socially at all. You know that.
Nope.
But he would. He would wear it if he was going to do a show for people.
His humility is what I was taken by. And when Barbara Walters interviewed him, I think one of the questions was she asked him what he thought was his greatest attraction, whether the voice or the talent or what. He said, I'm just an ordinary singer. Oh, you realize the people that he influenced, mm-hmm. he and Sinatra have influenced the world, you know?
Yes.
But I really think that he meant that. Sure.
I really think he meant that. He thought that.
In his last Christmas special, Bing and I sang Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas.
The model turned actress, Twiggy.
Although I was really, you know, thrilled to work with him, I was very nervous. It's hard to sing with Bing Crosby. And we sat down and started the song, which we were doing live. And he sang the first verse and he started to sing. And I think the loveliest thing, which struck me at the time, was that he really sang to me. He looked at me right into my eyes, which I think most people don't do. You know, when you sing a duet, they kind of don't really look at you, and he really did. And I think that really dispelled my nervousness, because I got caught up in the magic of him singing to me, and I really looked back at him, and I started to sing, and before I knew it, we'd done the song, and it was lovely, and I wasn't nervous anymore, and I think that was one of the qualities he had, of just making everything magical and work. And you know, now when I hear the song, I'm mixed with obvious sadness, but also a lovely kind of warm feeling, because it was such a lovely moment for me. And I'm glad that I was given that moment to work with a lovely man like that. A very magical man.
For me, he was unique in the sense
Frank Capra.
I thought he was the voice of America, would be one way of putting it, the song of America, the songs for America, about America. And in a way, I thought he was doing for America with songs what I was trying to do with films, lift the spirit of the American people during the time of their depression, the time of their trouble. And make them forget their troubles and tell them that tomorrow would be a better day than today.
Nobody ever thought of Bing being shy, you know? But he was.
Jane Wyman.
And if I were to give him a compliment and I'd say, well, we used to do this as a joke on the set, and I said, you did that real good, boss. And even that would kind of, he'd wink and he'd kind of walk away. Because he couldn't really accept an accolade.
Of course, I'll never forget it, naturally, working with Bing Crosby and my first lead. So it was a very exciting and wonderful experience. And I remember in those days, Bing's ears stuck out a little bit, as everyone knows, no secret. And they would, you know, tape them back or stick them back. And one time, the stick-em didn't hold too well, and this one ear popped out in the scene. Well, we got hysterical over that. But later on, thank goodness, Bing was recognized as a
wonderful actor, divine singer, and he didn't need to have his ears stuck back. He didn't need any of that at all.
You're the type of guy that would hang in there with you, give you...
Donald O'Connor.
Any type of advice that you wanted or anything that you needed, he was always there. Not obtrusively, mind you. He wouldn't come to you, but if you ever needed anything, yes, at least he would listen.
I would love to have been Bing's best friend. Unfortunately, I wasn't. This is a human being. This is a guy that was rather afraid of his position. And in this business, you're rejected every 5 minutes. You really are.
If you're going to write a song that please him for a picture, one of the things that Johnny Burke and I used to have to avoid was the declarative statement, I love you. In almost every love song we wrote for him, there was no I love you out and out. It was off-the-cuff kind of an I love you. For instance, in Moonlight Becomes You, at the end of the song, it doesn't say I love you. It says, if I say I love you, I want you to know it's not just because there's moonlight, although moonlight becomes you so.
We were having dinner with Bing and his then very young four sons, and I think Gary was being a little... Gary was being a little bit, you know, not eating his spinach or something, and his old man, Bing, said, well, so you want to be a mule? Go ahead. Big bell rang in that Irishman's mind. Swinging on a Star was born.
That time, the war was on.
Right.
And, of course, Der Bingle and Bob and their and armed forces. And, I mean, it was the most exciting time. But you felt this big, you know. And I was going to be in a picture with Bing, and Paul Draper was in it. And then he was replaced by Fred Astaire.
Right.
And I was just awed, and I acted it in the picture. And my mouth was, like, open. Uh-huh. You know, Bing would say something, and I go, what? You know, it was stunning.
But Bing did love you, though, didn't he? Come on, Joe. Call right. Bill. Come on. A little secret.
Oh, I don't
Bing.
Know.
Well, hello.
You know what he liked about me? I was, I wore little white gloves and a little white collar, and I was very, from like a girl's school.
Right.
He used to call me.
Sweet. West, you look sweet.
West
sweet.
Orange, Wisteria. Right. Sweet and clean cut. Uh-huh. Well, I have to tell you something. If you had the most famous man in the world, now Bing is not the most gorgeous man. You know, he had a shaped like a milk bottle. But anyway, when he opened his mouth to sing, and he used to sing songs to me every week on the Kraft Music Hall, like You Are Too Beautiful and, oh, I don't know.
He'd never realized how great he was. Bing Crosby always was a nice family man. He was a family man, wasn't he?
I think he realized exactly who he was.
I saw him on Robert Walters' show.
And then he tried to play it down. Bing was one of the smartest men I've ever met. And he tried to, you know,
play it down
and be cool, because Bob would play the other way.
I see.
And no, Bing knew exactly who he was. And he had a little bit of ice water for blood.
Did he really?
Oh, yeah. I mean, Bing would be your pal the night before with you'd meet people and have a couple of drinks with him. The next day on the set, he wouldn't even know them. He had Norwegian blood in him, you know, as well as Irish, and he was had that cool side.
But his family, he was very strict with his children, wasn't he, Joan?
I don't know. I didn't know that part of him. Uh-huh. I don't think he spent much time with them. He was always touring with the golf and you know, busy recording.
Yes.
It's true he wasn't very demonstrative with friends or people he loved, but you knew when he did like you. When I read a lot about Bing's romance with Catherine Grant and...
Merle Oberon.
I was terribly happy that, you know, something lovely was coming into his life. So when I saw him, I said, Bing, what about Catherine? And she said, oh, very, very nice girl. I said, what about marriage? Oh, it's ridiculous. He said, I'm much too old for her. She's a very young girl. And I said, Bing, really, what do numbers matter? I mean, it's if you and she get on well together and you love her and she loves you, that's the most important thing, really. And I didn't see him for a while, and I read that they were married. And I think it was a lovely marriage.
The most fun I've had on the show and the most enjoyment I've had were two men named Bing Crosby and Phil Harris. The late Bing Crosby was a private man, sort of a shy man, highly intelligent,
and a man who truly loved the outdoors. I did 5 shows with Bing, and I really got to know him. I'll never forget one day we were driving down the highway from Sacramento. He was taking me to the airport, and he turned the car radio on. And here was, when I was a boy, the most famous voice in the world. And they started to play Raindrops Are Falling on My Head, and he started to go boom, 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 boom. And then he just started to sing for about a half hour right down that highway. And suddenly they went into a commercial, he turned it on. I said, "You really like to sing, don't you, Bing?" And he said, "I love it." And I guess that's the way I feel about the outdoors. I never will forget that drive down the coast with Bing Crosby.
I called Maury Luxford, who I was helping put on the tournament.
Fred McMurray.
I said, "Maury, did Bing know I was sick last year and couldn't make it?" He said, "Well, I don't know, Fred." He said, "Why?" I said, "Well, because I didn't get an invitation." Well, he said, "You know, once you turn it down, you don't get another one." And I said, "Well, gee, Maury, I was sick." And he said, "Well, let me see what I can do." And I waited around a couple of days, and then I got a nice letter from Bing saying, "Look, I didn't know you were sick, and if you want to play, let me know, and you can come up." I said, "Well, Bing," I called him, and I said, "It isn't so much that I want to play. I just wanted to get the invitation, you know."
The thing that nobody understood about the Kraft Music Hall was what they saw was the rehearsal.
Crosby's chief writer,
Carroll. Run through in its entirety before it went on the air. We used to rehearse each segment separately, each guest separate from the other, except where they interchanged. And so the whole show came as a surprise to a lot of people on the show. Only Bing knew the whole thing.
Bing rehearsed his songs, of course.
Ken Carpenter.
It came down to the conversation, the script. Why, that was we did as little rehearsing as possible because we wanted to make it sound spontaneous. And this was Bing's way of doing things, his way of talking, a way of great ease and no pressure at all.
I wasn't a fan of Mr. Crosby's at all. I didn't like his acting, and I didn't like his singing.
Bing's butler,
and I think
Alan
that's
Fisher.
Why, my feelings about him are totally different from all the rest of the people that he knew, his friends, and all the, of course, legion of fans that he had. I liked him because of his kind of humble, unassuming way and his total simplicity and his sort of matter-of-fact way of life. Of all the years I was with Bing Crosby, I think Bob Hope came once with Dolores Hope for dinner. Phil Harris and Alice Faye once in 16 years. Fred Astaire in London once for dinner. You know, I think the reason was his home life, to him, was almost sacred. When he came in his front door, he closed the door, and that was the outside world locked outside. Extremely rare, very, very rare. In fact, if it was 2 or 3 times in any given year that we'd have a dinner party that, you know, close friends would be invited. And yet, the amusing thing to me, and more amazing than amusing, was the inordinate lengths he would go to entertain fans in his home, especially if he knew that they'd come great distances. They'd always write in advance and say, "We're coming, we live in Australia, we're going to be in San Francisco on this date or that date." Even if it meant altering a luncheon date or calling him from the golf course, he'd say, "I've got to see these people."
I was 15 years old, 14 or 15, and we idolized Bing. And for us to be standing around a microphone, and everything was done live, of course. So Bing is right standing next to us, and we're on another bike over here. It was just the thrill of our lives up until that time. Years later, I had a television show of my own, a weekly show, and Bing was booked on the show. That was a big, big thrill to sing with him later on, sitting 2 guys on a stool, you know, like we were equal. And it was just thrilling to me. I'll never forget it.
She was standing in the wings, trembling with fear. She was almost hysterical. She said, "I cannot go out there because they're all going to be looking to see if they're stars, and it's going to be terrible." Bing said, "What's going on?" I told him what happened, and he walked out on stage. And he said, "We got a friend here, just had a little trouble recently. You probably heard about it. Everything is fine now. She needs our love. She needs our support. She's here. Let's give it to her, okay? Here's Judy. And she came out, and that place went crazy. And she just blossomed.
Bing Crosby. Bing Crosby. Bing was he was a very cold man. He was a very aloof man, but he could be very warm on occasion. Also very funny. He had good vocabulary, good instincts, and he was a gentleman. I liked Bing, although I was sometimes afraid of him.
Bing explained one thing to me very early on. He wanted to be left in the dressing room as long as possible. He said he knew what he was doing. No matter what they said to him, he told me to tell them, bring me out at the last minute. So if I was dressing Bing, and I quite often did, he would say, come in and get me dressed at the last minute. I'll be ready and be out there before they're ready. And that was it. He wanted to stay in the dressing room, usually watching a golf game or some other sports. And when he got on stage, he was incredible. From the moment he started rehearsal, he was letter perfect. I mean, the first day of rehearsal, he knew every song, he knew the script, and if there were changes made, he'd grab onto them immediately.
We wanted Bing Crosby, if anybody can believe this, because we were big fans of him. He was a terrific dramatic actor, if you remember, Man on Fire. He was very, very good. We saw the pipe instead of the cigar. He was very laid back. He could play the humble. I mean, it's not a weird a stretch as it first appears to be. We sent him the script. He sent us a nice letter back, liked the script, liked the character, but he said, look, I'm retired now. I'm playing golf. He lived in Hillsborough, a very rich suburb of San Francisco. He said, I hear television is a real rat race and a meat grinder. So that was it.
To a four-picture deal at Paramount. And that's how I did Anything Goes with Donald and with Bing Crosby. And Bing Crosby, Taurus, divine, perfect, fun. He used to call me Brookie. Why do you call me Brookie? He said, well, darling, because when you walk away, you look like a little brook trout going upstream. Who wouldn't love somebody like that?
It's perfect. No, I did Dr. Cook
somewhere. Dr. Cook's Garden, yeah. That was for ABC.
That was for ABC. I did Dr. Cook's Garden.
Tell me about what the movie was.
Dr. Cook's Garden was a story of Ira Levin. It was a mystery story, a thriller, about a doctor who kills people he thinks he weeds his garden, and the town was his garden, and he was a murderer. Bing Crosby was the lead in the show. Bing Crosby had, and Doug Kramer was the executive producer. It was for Paramount, and I was called out to Hollywood to audition for Bing Crosby. Ted Post at that time was assigned as the director, who I knew very well. And Bing Crosby said to me, how should he play the part? And I said, well, that's really not up to me. It's the director. He said, I'm asking you how I should play the part. And the only thing I could think of was, I said, don't be Bing Crosby. Just don't play Bing Crosby. And I got the job. Now I'm in Vermont. The whole thing is being shot in location. And I'm to pick up Bing Crosby at the airport. I go to Boston, and he comes off the plane, and he's got a beard just like mine, and his hair is like mine. And I said, excuse me, but what is that all about? He said, well, you told me not to be like me, so I've decided if I'm a murderer, I'm going to be like you. And he played the whole thing in a beard, doing me. And it was a good show. A Blythe Danner was in it, Frank Converse. Shot it all up in Vermont. And it was an interesting experience. It was a delight to work with. I really enjoyed him.
Crosby adopted me right away. I became one of his. Bing was, you can't explain, I can't explain Bing. He was the most, to me, most fantastic human being. If I might digress, during the war, while I was flying and under some very tough situations, he wrote me the most wonderful letters. He was responsible for getting me transferred because my citizenship was in limbo. And he was responsible for getting me transferred to the American Air Corps in London. And ultimately, you know, I probably would have ended up staying in Europe if it wouldn't have been for Bing.
Is he also responsible for your name?
Yes, yeah. He once said to me, get your name straightened out if you're going to compete. And his psychology was that his name had been Harry. And he talked about Broadway always, and the Whiteman Band, and the rhythm boys that he sang with. And he said, nobody ever heard of me as Harry Crosby. And he said, don't look upon it as a nickname, look upon it as a name that you could live with. And he nagged me, because they would call me the sketch kid, they called me everything, but or CD, which I, again, loathed. And he nagged me till I changed it, changed my passport, my life. Only Bing. Crosby used to say to me, never say no, always say yes, and then do what the hell you want. And I think that's really a very good philosophy.
Bing Crosby, probably one of the most intelligent people I've ever worked with. Bing, when he was in his 70s, I did like four Christmas specials and another special with him. Bing was always anxious to try something new. I would write brand new material for him, sketches, musical numbers, and he would thrive on it. He loved that. He would learn it and he would rehearse it, you know, and he, at that age, you figure.
He was a very thoughtful and a very caring person, and he was very much a family man. He loved his family. You know, his brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews. He put me through college, and after I graduated, which I was in theater arts, speech and drama, and he asked me what I wanted to do, and I said, well, you know, I wanted to do some acting. And he said, well, come on down here with me. Come down here to Hollywood. So next thing I knew, I was on a plane and living with him and my grandmother. She was living at the house also. Mm-hmm. And he got me a job at Paramount Studios, and I was there for a year as a contract player. So he was very influential in the early part of my life, absolutely.
The question I have to ask, did Bing ever just casually croon around the house?
Yes.
He did?
Yes. As I think I mentioned earlier, after my grandfather died, Bing contacted his mother and said, you know, I don't want you to live alone there. You come and live with me. So Aunt Dixie had passed away. And so it made a wonderful arrangement. So I would go visit my grandmother and Uncle Bing. And when time came for, say, breakfast or dinner or whatever, Uncle Bing had come down the hallway. Come on, Carolyn, let's go. It's time. On the table. Oh, okay. So we'd start walking down the hall and down the staircase. He was humming or whistling or singing something. He had music around him all the time. And somebody had brought up the point that even his speaking voice was musical. If you ever heard anything that was done, you know, off the record, so to speak, well, hi there, Michael, how you doing today? It sounds wonderful, don't you think? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The way the voice would go up and down like that.
What was your relationship with Bing?
He became my friend.
As a result of what?
As a result of the show. I only met him through the show.
Which show are we talking about?
The Bing Crosby Christmas. There were 10 Bing Crosby Christmas specials, of which there were 12. I did 10 of the 12. One Dwight and Gary did in London, and I forget where the other one was. And he just enjoyed working with me, and I enjoyed him. I loved the way he was with his family. I saw those children grow in 10 years. I saw Catherine, the mother, school them during rehearsal. I saw his willingness to try to do different things that he normally didn't do. He was a stand-up singer, he did drama on the show. He moved around. He sang with his children, and they were very precious Christmas shows. And no better singer for White Christmas. We did White Christmas on all 10 shows and made a montage of it, and the children grew as the song progressed. It was one of the delightful moments of the last one I did with him.
Now, not every performer that you work with became your personal friend as a result of that. But in Crosby's case, you did maintain a relationship with him.
Yes. The first year that I worked with him, you know, Bing then smoked a pipe. And I saw in front of him at the table when we were reading a tobacco pouch. It was the ugliest tobacco pouch I have ever seen in my life. It looked like a drowned muskrat. So I said to my assistant, during the lunch break, I want you to go out. I want you to go to Dunhill's. You got 1 hour. I want the finest tobacco pouch you can get with his initials, and I want it back here by the time we're ready to go. Sure enough, he was back, and in front of Bing was this box. Now we're ready to continue the reading. Bing opens it up, and he sees the tobacco pouch. Thanks. Nice working with you, whatever I said, Bob. And he put the cover back on the box. He said, come here. He took me over to the corner. He said, don't ever buy me anything. He said, you know what I have to do now? I have to call my secretary. I have to dictate a thank you note. I don't know your address. I'll have to call your office. This will go on forever. And then I'll have to give you a gift. Don't give me a gift, ever.
So, and Gary was more important to me because I wanted to take him through his own book, page by page by page, which I did, discovered that he had not really written the book and hadn't even read a lot of it.
No.
So that was very useful, especially for the first volume. But now Gary's dead. He died of a heart attack. I think he was just 62. And I'm sitting in my office Sunday night, and it's Philip. I didn't even know he got my number. And he, I couldn't get him off the phone. He was,
wow.
He was on a lot of uppers at the time. And finally, after 2 hours, madly writing down everything I can as fast as I can, I said, Philip, you're wearing me out. Can we continue this? Oh, I'm so sorry. He said, you know, I didn't really mean to hold you. I said, are you kidding? This is just wonderful that you called. And so we started a regular thing of like once a week. We would talk for an hour or so. And whatever Gary said, Phil said exactly the opposite. But Phil, because he worshipped his father and had more problems with his mother, gave me an insight into the marriage that would have simply been unavailable to me.
When I started on the book, I remember the great jazz saxophonist Jimmy Heath saying to me, oh, Bing Crosby, I want to read that. And I said, were you a Crosby fan? And he said, well, he's an African-American musician. And he says, well, Crosby was the only guy in the air, meaning the only white guy, because that's all that was on the air, who had time. So that's where we got the songs from. And he never lost that ability. Can I tell you a fast story about his
sure.
time?
Yeah.
In the later years, in the 70s, American record companies wouldn't record him. He was very passé. Rock, you know, the Beatles and Bob Dylan and the Stones and all of that, everything had changed. And so Bing made a couple of records that he paid for himself and then leased to small labels that were distributed. But in England, which remembered him from the war and which was much more loyal, he still remained very big, and he went over there routinely to record. And he made some very fine records for the major labels in Britain. At one of them, the big band that was hired to accompany him consisted, you know, largely of young studio musicians who loved jazz, who spent all the time listening to Coltrane and Sonny Rollins and Miles Davis and so forth. And they had grown up hearing about Crosby and hearing their parents play him. And the conductor of the orchestra, who was, I guess, about 28 or 29 at the time, was a tenor saxophone named Alan Cohn, not to be confused with the great American jazz saxophonist Al Cohn. Anyway, Alan Cohn, he said during the break, the guys were all talking, this Bing is really something. They liked him personally, and he's really good. And they were stunned by how easily he could swing. So they decided to play a trick on him. The next take, the rhythm section was going to syncopate its, you know, head off. The drummer was going to drop bombs. The bass player was going to do all kinds of stuff to see if they could knock him off his perch. And they couldn't. And when they were done, they did another take because the ensemble didn't sound great. But after that, they walked over to Bing and said, Mr. Crosby, we have to tell you, we were really trying to, drive you crazy on that to see if we could unseat you from the perfect time. And Bing said, I'll tell you why you couldn't. He said, all I listen for is the one. If I can hear the one, I don't care how much shit you put on top of it, it's not going to bug me.
That's awesome. And yeah, he's described as having Basie time by some clever...
Jake Hanna, the great jazz drummer, said, he was telling me, he said, Crosby had the best time of anybody. He had time like Zoot Sims. He had times like, you know, he was mentioning all these great players. And then he sputtered and he said, let me just put it this way. He had Basie time, because Basie is like, you know, he's like the metronome, a living metronome. Nobody has greater time than Count Basie.
And they said to Rosemary, well, was he really a great singer? And she looked at the interviewer as though he were insane. Yes, he was a very great singer. He had unbelievable pitch. He had the best low notes in the business and the best high notes when he was in really good voice. He had incredible time. And you know who his biggest, some of his biggest fans were through his whole career? Opera singers. Like Lisa Stevens, who worked with him in Going My Way. He had a huge following in the opera world because he made it seem so easy.
And he also had a huge admirer in Louis Armstrong. And you've got a quote from Louis where he says Bing was the boss of all singers.
Right. Well, you know, and when Bing was asked in the early 50s, who did you learn the most from? Bing's answer was, I'm proud to be a lifelong member of the congregation of Reverend Satchel Mount.
One of the first things I did was I put the Crosby discographies and the Armstrong discographies together. And it is amazing how often Lewis covered tunes that Bing had just recorded. And it occurred to me that it was partly this friendship between them that encouraged Armstrong to start doing Tin Pan Alley. You know, instead of just, you know, St. James Infirmary and original type jazz pieces, he would do just a gigolo. He did. They were always the pieces that Bing had, Wrap Your Troubles and Dreams, which was written for Crosby. Joe Bushkin told me they were sitting backstage at one of these tours, and Bing got very meditative, and he started talking about the first time he saw him. And then he said, you know, Louis Armstrong is the greatest popular singer that ever lived or ever will live. And Bushkin said, well, we all love pops, but are you thinking of something specific? And he said, when he sings a sad song, you cry. When he sings a happy song, you laugh. What the hell else is there in popular music? Yeah. Crosby was, you know, he insisted when he got to produce his first film in 1936, Pennies from Heaven, he insisted that Armstrong be billed. That first of all, he insisted Armstrong be in the movie, and the producer was like, why? You know, isn't there some black guy in Los Angeles? If you have to have some jazz person that we can find, do we have to really fly? And one of the things I really came to admire about Crosby is that he didn't negotiate. If he knew he was right, he would just say, I'm going to play golf. Call me when you change your mind. And everybody knew that about him, so they had to sign Louis Armstrong. And then Crosby said, and he's going to be billed with me above the title. No black performer had been billed in a white film before. He's only in the movie for 7 minutes. In 1956, the first important show that Bing ever did on television was called the Edsel Show, to promote that beloved car that Ford put out, named after his son Edsel. And Armstrong had just told, attacked Eisenhower for not going to Little Rock. It was front page news. A lot of performers completely freaked out. He was attacked in editorials all over the country. So Ford called CBS, which was doing the show, and said, look, this is about promoting a car. The last thing we need is controversy. We can't have Louis Armstrong on this. Tell Bing we'll do another show later. And CBS, the head of CBS, called Crosby and told him this. And Bing said, well, if you don't want Louis on the show, that's your business, but I won't be there either. Oh. And so not only did Armstrong appear on the show, but the show opens with Crosby and Armstrong doing Now You Has Jazz. In 1976, Crosby came to New York to do a show at the Eurus Theater. because I was doing this piece for The Voice, for some reason I got into the rehearsal, and there was nobody else in the theater in the rehearsal except The Voice photographer and myself. And as the rehearsal finished, his representative came over to me and said, I can give you 2 minutes alone with Mr. Crosby before the press comes in. So I said, great. I didn't know what I was going to say. But everybody was talking at that time about the fact that both of them had just done programs. They did each a program solo with David Frost. And then they did one, the two of them, with David Frost. And on the one Armstrong did, he talked about how long he's known Crosby and that they go friends, you know, back to the 20s. But that in all those years, he had never invited me out to the house. So, you know, being a Village Voice writer, I walked over to him and I said, you know, he was shook hands and I said, I have to ask you, did you hear about what Louis Armstrong said about, you know, not being invited to your house? And he said, well, you know, Pops and Lucille never had me to their house. I thought that was the coolest, wittiest possible response there could be. And the fact that he said Pops, that sort of lets you know right away. And then when I started researching, I found these letters that went back. You know, Armstrong adored Crosby. And, well, just to go back to the house, I have to say, I told this story to Rosemary Clooney, who became a very good friend and enabled me to do a lot of things I wouldn't have been able to do in this book. And Rosemary said, the thing Pops didn't understand was that nobody was invited to the Crosby house. You know, that's where he went to get away from.
I mean, he just never socialized at home?
He socialized in the earlier years, but after the house burned down, their mansion burned down in the first days of 1943, and they moved into a much larger house in Holmby Hills. And at that point, the marriage was really in bad shape, and he was away all the time. And when he came home, he just wanted to disappear into his study or, you know, or be with his family, trying to make up time that he had lost. And I see the notebook, this address book, and I open it up, and it's the first couple of pages are just phone numbers and people. And I had taken it from Catherine because I thought it might give me some names that I would not otherwise have even looked into that might have some resonance in the story. And then I sort of focused my eyes and realized to my absolute astonishment, I mean, this could almost make a religious believer of me, that this was the only journal Crosby ever kept in his life, and it was about London and France. It was about the stuff that the period that I didn't have material on. And not only was it an amazing document in that it gave me, when he didn't know where he was, which he frequently didn't, because this was Jeep traveling right near the front, right not far from the German line, started coming in through Cherbourg, where he landed with Fred Astaire, and then they started to move east, and as they got towards where the Metz campaign was, this is where the Germans were still trying, Patton was still trying to win Metz so that then they could make the eastern shove right into the over the Rhine. And so Crosby would go out in the morning with his troop in a jeep, and sometimes they knew where they were, and sometimes they would stop when they found a group of men, and there was nothing really that planned. But Crosby was incredible, because even when he didn't know where he was, he would give coordinates. And with Google Maps and his coordinates, I could pretty much figure out where he was. He said he's never going to be seen with a politician again. He just didn't feel it was right for a film star to use his popularity to promote it. And in fact, he had some real difficulty, you know, when you visited Bob Hope's office, you know, a picture of him playing golf with Spiro Agnew and Gerald Ford and every politician of the last 50 years. The only photograph that Crosby ever allowed with a politician was with his old friend Shirley Temple Black, who didn't get elected. But when I went to the Crosby home a few weeks, I was in San Francisco, and Catherine Crosby came to the book signing and invited me to the house, and we did a long, leisurely walk through this magnificent mansion in Hillsborough. And there was a little private place in his study, and sure enough, there's half a dozen pictures of Bing with politicians. Oh. But not one of them was ever shown publicly or published. Hmm. He would not allow that.
Were they all Republican?
Oh, not at all. He supported JFK. He hated Nixon. Uh-huh. I mean, his politics were... He was a conservative Republican. He was against the war in Vietnam. Came out in the Wall Street Journal. I think actually it was in the Daily News that he gave an interview, which he said. He was in favor of the legalization of marijuana. He was completely ahead of the curve on civil rights any kind of issue like that. Anthony Quinn said to me once, Bing Crosby was the first person I ever met in Hollywood who didn't talk to me like I was a Mex. You know, I heard gay people telling me that he was completely, you know, just live and let live. He just never felt a breeze from him. I interviewed a woman who later went on to become quite successful on television. She produced a show called The Rockford Files. Some of you remember that, James Garner. And she was on the left in the late 40s. Her husband was George Rosenberg, who was Bing's agent. But Mita Rosenberg was called before Hugh Ack, and she named names to her everlasting regret. And she was very candid about it. And I said, I never understood why they didn't call Crosby. They called his friends, Gary Cooper, they called Leo McCarey, they called, you know, Disney, Crosby knew. And she said, are you kidding? If they had called Crosby, he would have told them to fuck off. And what are they going to do? Say, Bing Crosby's a communist? And I said, but are you confident that he would really have said fuck off to Hewitt? And she said, if you don't understand that about Bing, you don't understand anything about Bing. And it's very interesting when you read the HUAC transcripts, because a lot of the people on the right, you know, Republican conservatives in the Crosby circle, they testified, but they didn't name names. They had no names to mention. Gary Cooper was never in a communist cell. Who was he going to name? You know, and yet the really bad sons of bitches, they did. There were ways that he could have, that you could testify and keep some of your self-respect. But Crosby, she said Crosby would never, never have bowed his head to those people.
Day by day, I'm falling more in love with you. And day by day, my love seems to grow. There isn't any end to my devotion.
You keep rocking 7 nights a week. You just go. Not that I'm a knocking. Rockin', but whoa, baby, whoa, 7 nights a week, you keep on.
Sunrise, sunset, sunrise, sunset, swiftly flow the day. Seedlings turn old overnight to sunflowers, blossoming even as we gaze. Sunrise, sunset, sunrise, sunset, swiftly fly the years. One season following another,
then give you the big eye when that sweet talking's done. A woman's a two-face, a wearisome thing who'll leave you to sing the blues. the train a-callin' hooey, my mama done told me. Hear that lonesome whistle blowin' across the trestle, hooey, my mama done told me. A-hooey, da-hooey, old clickety-clack echoin' back the blues in the night. The evening breeze will start the trees.
Keep that breathless charm.
Won't you please arrange it? 'Cause I love you just the way.
Size of your bet, divide by the size of the shoes, add the age multiplied by the length of the stride, providing you win, you can't lose.
Well, 20 years have passed. I've put on a little around the middle, lost considerable off the top, but Moonlight Bay is still there. Lindsay?
We were sailing alone.
Sailing in a souped-up hot rod outboard yet. Some
on
sailing.
Moonlight Bay.
Ah, yes, the bay. I was very big on the bay. They
we
adored me.
We could hear the voices ringing.
Hubba-bubba-boo.
Oh, no. Are you in pain?
Don't knock that. Kept you in bubble gum for years. Yes, you've stolen most of my good neckties, too, lady.
Now, don't go away.
Oh, don't yeah, go away.
As we sang those old sweet song on Moonlight Bay.
For we would say,
sailing along on the beautiful moonlight.
We sailed along the beautiful Moonlight Bay.
For all the lovely delight I found in your embrace.
You're not suffering enough. Suffer a little.
I'm thankful, though I know it's ending all too soon. And thanks for unforgettable nights I never can replace. And memories that linger like a haunting tune.
Pardon me, do you mind if I say a little tune? You conductor, you? Oh, yes.
Santa Claus is here to pay a call with a precious gift for one and all.
I'll lay you 8 to 5 that we'll meet Dorothy Lamour.
You just listen here to me.
I know. I ain't a big catfish in the sea, ba 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 boo.
You got a pinnacle deck in your pocket?
What happened to Mom's wedding ring? Did you hawk it?
Oh, yeah.
Not so loud.
Where somebody waits for me, sugar sweet, so is she. I said bye.
From the field that comes the breath of new mown hay.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. In that small cafe, the park across the way, the children's carousel, the chestnut trees, the...
I'll stay away, but it costs more than I can pay. Without you, I can't make my way. I surrender, dear. I may seem proud, and I may act gay. That's just a pose. I'm not that way, 'cause deep down in my heart I say, I surrender, dear. Are those little mean things we were doing?
When you're in love, you're a man on fire. And a man on fire is a man to behold. His kind of love is no ordinary thing, but as lovely as music and as precious as spring. And where there should be love, we'd lay on you heavenly flowers. I dreamed of paradise for two. You are my paradise, simply dear. You are my dream.
Came up with a great idea last night.
One of those things that rings a bell.
So I kind of looked at baby, and baby said maybe.
There wasn't any maybe till the moon came up with a great idea last night.
Suddenly everything was swell.
And before I knew it, baby was holding me tight.
The stars winked overhead like they knew she was due to confess. Not a word was said. What a wonderful way to say yes.
Yes, the moon came up with a great idea, all right.
She saw the light.
And there won't be any maybe with baby tonight.
Oh, it was a great idea.
Just great.
Thank you.
the moon came up with a great idea last night. Yes, it took the moon to do it, 'cause before I knew it, baby was holding me tight,
tender but tight.
The stars winked overhead
like they knew she was due to confess. Not a word was said.
It's a wonderful way to say yes. The moon came up with a great idea, all right. Too big to fight, and there won't be any maybe with baby tonight. And there won't be any maybe with baby tonight, tonight, tonight.
September, November, and these few precious days I'll spend with you. My own true love, my own true love, at last I've found you. Love, no lips but yours, no arms but yours. Past a shadowy lane, and I thought about you. Two or three cars parked under the stars in a winding stream. Moon shining down on some little town with each beam. You can say your lips are not for me, but you can't hide the kiss.
That's old Cindy Lou going with me.
Gone fishing. Fleas are biting at his hide.
Get away from me, boys, you're bothering me. Folks won't find us now because Mr. Satch and Mr. Cross, we gone fishing instead of just a wishing.
Bapa baby, bapa baby, mother.
Oh, yeah.
Mr. B double O Z,
that sure spells booze.
You will wind up wearing tattered shoes if you mess with Mr. Booze.
Don't mess with Mr. Booze. Don't mess with Mr. Booze.
Don't mess with
let's have it understood. We will be together just the way we should. Let's not wait and hope. Sweet Leilani, heavenly flower, tropic skies are jealous as they shine.
My sweet Leilani,
I think they're jealous of your blue eyes.
Oh, lovely Leilani,
jealous because you're mine. Sweet Leilani, heavenly flower, I dreamed of paradise for two.
My sweet.
Oh, Mr. Mercer, Mr. Mercer, Mr. Mercer, Mr. Mercer, I believe that its foundation came from them.
Are you positive?
Yeah.
It's been a joy, I can't deny. Though some may think I took things lightly, but man and boy, I looked on high.